Okay, hello everybody. We are already 15 minutes late, so we better start. So this is a group, working group on mapping the worker struggles and the position of labor in post-socialism. My name is Jovica Lončar. I come from organization named Organization for Workers Initiative and Democratization from Zagreb. And I got the task to assemble this group. And so I will just give a brief intro of all the members and what were the aims when I was thinking about who to invite and so on. So basically, I had two aims. First was to connect people with different backgrounds. And when we say different backgrounds, what is meant is that in this group we had people who were coming from trade unions, and what is important, from different levels in trade unions. So we had people who are actually quite high in trade union hierarchy, who were somewhere in the middle, and those who are actually, let's say, grassroots activists inside the trade union movement. We also had people who are not organized in trade unions, and who fought very serious battles defending their factories and their working place, so people who are, let's say, just workers. We also had people who are coming from, let's say, non-governmental sector or so-called activists. And what was also important was to get the people who come from academia. And I'm quite happy that we were able to reach this first aim, and actually we did have people from all these backgrounds, and my impression is that they were able to connect. Second aim, and you're going to see that these two aims that we set, or I set before this group, are quite modest, and the second one was to gather knowledge. So my impression after the last Balkan Forum was, and still is, that we do not have enough knowledge about what's going on in different Balkan countries. And that is the first condition to get that knowledge, so we could do something productive in means of what has been discussed during these couple of days here in Balkan Forum. And I'm quite happy to say also that I think that we managed in gathering this knowledge. I'm just going to... So, but as you can see, these two aims ended up in a lot of people being members of the group, of this group, so I actually write all the names down because it's a lot of people. So here I'm going to start actually from this side. Marko Grdešić from Croatia, Petr Damo from Romania, Heiko Bilder from Germany, Milenko Srečković from Serbia, Tibor Mesman, Serbia, Hungary, Stipe Čurković from Croatia. And actually we are missing quite a lot of people due to various reasons. So part of our group were also three trade unions from Croatia, Jasna Petrović, Davor Rakić and Mario Ivković. They could not be with us today. For instance, Mario Ivković is at the moment organizing a strike of Croatian Airlines, so... Davor Rakić from Petrokemija Kutina, one very important case of work of really successful worker struggle against privatization in Croatia, also had to go, so couldn't be with us today because last week there were another new rumors about Petrokemija going to privatization. That is something that is happening quite often in the last 15 years that are battling against it. And Jasna Petrović, who is actually a top level trade union organizing, couldn't be with us because they have a meeting of today. We also had one trade unionist from Slovenia, that is Goran Lukic. We had Maja Breznik and Romana Zidar, who are, let's say, NGO activists from Slovenia. Then Branislav Markuš and Robert Faj, who are workers of Jugoremedia Zrenjanin. Also one really important example of worker struggles. I would say that Those two, that one in Kutina and this one in Zrenjanin are quite similar in a lot of things, and we are quite happy that we could get people from those both factories. And with us was also Ivan Zlatic, activist from Belgrade. And I think that is it. Did I forget anybody? I think not. So as you can see, it was quite a large group. Before I give word to Marco, who is going to present the work of our group, and I have to stress that this is actually work in progress. It's not something that is already finished, and so you don't have to be afraid that we are going to use this position to direct the struggles in the Balkans for the next period. One more thing that I also have to stress is that maybe one of the most valuable things that came out from our meetings and discussions is that all the people wanted to continue with this work. So we do not actually we don't think that this should be the end. So we just write the paper, and then you all say, okay, that paper is terrible. It's not radical enough. It doesn't tackle all the issues. It doesn't come from the empirical battles or research and so on, but we actually want to continue this model of people who are coming from different backgrounds to exchange information, and maybe in some 5, 10, or as Samir Amin would tell, 300 years, we are going to be able to come up with something that could be useful in actual fight. But now, not to privatize the time anymore, I'm going to give word to Marco. After him, our discussant, Catherine Samary from France, who is going to be very critical, I hope, to what Marco is going to say. And then we can have a discussion. And of course, I want also to stress that we are all in this together, so all the comments, all the questions and everything. And yes, if some questions maybe are going to raise, so I hope there are not going to be any questions, so we can go outside and you can discuss. But if some questions maybe going to raise, that somebody thinks that some of us who are working in the group should comment something, then we are going to be very happy to give our stance. Okay, that is it, Marco.
Thank you, Jovica. My name is Marko, I'm from Croatia, and my task was to somehow summarize the discussion that we had, which is quite a challenging task. The discussion lasted for 2 days. Lots of people took part, and so finding a consensus isn't very easy. On the other hand, as you can imagine, with discussions like these, there's always a lot of digressions. People go on different tangents that they think are important, they may not be actually important for the group discussion and so on. And there was some of this, of course, as is always the case, but overall I felt there was a nice overlap between what people were saying. And there's people are coming to the same conclusions from different backgrounds. And the main strength of this group, I felt, was the combination of people from unions, NGOs, and academia, and the fact that not always, but many times, they were talking about the same things, but only in different, in a different language. I felt that was encouraging, and it also made me feel as if we're not really at the beginning anymore. We're a bit beyond the beginning, which doesn't mean that there isn't a lot of work left still to do. So our little memorandum here is sort of an attempt to do our share of the work and move things forward. This will be published as part of the Balkan Forum publication, if I'm right. Even when it's published, it's nothing that's set in stone, so this is something that should be seen as a kind of evolving document. So when we met, we implicitly agreed on several goals, which was to first of all connect this triangle, academia, NGOs, and unions, share information, share experience, and try to find a common language to what we are seeing around us and what we feel should be the next steps in the struggle. So searching for a common vocabulary, finding identities that we can that we can share, that are solidary, that are overlapping. Overall, the environment in which unions and activists and others operate in is very difficult, as you can probably witness yourself. So for unions especially, the situation is pretty serious. So all across the region, so we're here as part of the Balkan Forum, so we're focusing on the Balkan region. Most of us are from the former Yugoslavia, so within the Balkans, a bit more of the focus is on the former Yugoslavia. But almost everywhere you look, unions are in decline. So union membership is dropping. This is a big problem, and it's a long-term trend that has been going on since the early 90s, and it doesn't seem to be stopping. It's not stabilizing. So even in countries that are doing a bit better, say Slovenia, when it comes to union strength, union membership is around 30% or so, maybe even less. So our colleague from Zveza said that they organize 27% of the employed workers. So this is serious. This is a small number, especially compared to the beginning of the transition, where it was almost 90%, almost 100% of people were in unions. So the climate is serious, and there's a definite challenge of merely staying alive. On the other hand, the other side, the economic and political elites, are very aggressive and very capable in scoring victories. So the kinds of resources you need to fight this, this is very demanding. So you need both legal resources, you need a large membership base, you need people on the street, but you need expertise. There's simply not enough time in the day, and you don't simply have enough people for all the tasks that you should be doing. So the challenges are big. On the other hand, although we discussed these weaknesses of unions quite a bit, I felt that we also were fair to the unions in some respects by pointing out the things that they did well. And I think this is something they should advertise more, because whenever they do something well, they don't really get the praise they deserve. It's simply taken for granted. Oftentimes we only discuss the bad points of unions, and there's a lot of unions that do good work and aren't really noticed. So in this sense, there's a feeling in the group, I believe, that there should be more of an effort to build this collective consciousness and the collective memory of past successes. So we constantly keep forgetting things and losing this in a kind of constant amnesia. Whenever there's a labor victory, we lose it and forget it, and we have to relearn what we learned in the past, and we have to reinvent the wheel over and over. So in this respect, the next step, and there are already some tentative things being done about this, the next step is to build a kind of center, whatever you want to call it, research documentation, online or otherwise, which could somehow collect this information, make it publicly available, document things. Document strikes, document very boring things that are important to unions. For example, unions don't really know how many members they have. It's always a guess. It's always an estimate. And we would like to know how many members unions actually have. On the employer side, it's even worse. There's even less information on how many firms are actually members of employers' associations. But that's another story. So documenting things like this, data on strikes is very poor. So even in Slovenia, it's always data that you sort of trust. You don't really know if it's true. So this is something that may be seen as a kind of bureaucratic thing, boring, etc. But actually, I think it's very important in building this sense of we already have a tradition that we can build on. It's not square one. We have some victories that we can use, and we can use to and inspire ourselves for the next steps. This, of course, I think, this was also something that I think the group has a kind of consensus about. Whenever I realize I'm in the position of speaking in the name of the group, so, but take that with a grain of salt. I can't really do that. This is a group of individuals, and they all probably have slightly different opinions on this. But I think there was a point in our discussions that we all agreed on, which is that there's this need for constant communication across this segmentation of society. Society is segmented into sectors. NGOs don't really talk to unions. Unions don't really talk to NGOs. Although there are good practices when this actually takes place. And whenever this takes place, there's always something positive that comes out of it, I feel. Of course, this requires lots of organizational diplomacy between groups. You have to respect the other side, not take, not consider your own opinion as the most important, etc. But we have good practices, and maybe some people here can talk about this in Croatia, of the NGO that Jovica is involved in, and several other people working together with unions and actually having their people in unions do some volunteer work. And both sides were careful and suspicious at the beginning and didn't really know what to expect, but the overall experience, I feel, has been positive for both sides. So things can be done, but this requires lots of energy and lots of careful diplomacy between these groups, given that there's this climate of suspicion between the various sectors of society. There's always a kind of distrust, especially between NGOs and unions, because unions are seen as more traditional, old-fashioned, bureaucratic, etc., which sometimes they are, sometimes they aren't. But in any case, there's always real concrete people in these organizations that you can talk to and see for yourself. So I don't want to go into too much detail, but this necessity of linking up across sectors, I think, is very important. So building these solidary identities. Otherwise, you get cases of very successful unions, for example. One unionist who couldn't be here, but he said, this is a unionist from Petrokemija in Kutina, and they have been very successful in what they've done. From the late 90s, when privatization first began to threaten their company, they have been very successful in organizing against it and finding ways and building a union that is actually alive. And he said that a union is a living thing. It's a living organism. But he also felt that despite all the success they had in preserving their company, he feels like they could win victory after victory and still end up losing the war. So this isolated struggle isn't really enough in that sense. Maybe just a few more points. So one of the things that we discussed was this feeling of isolation and this feeling that your problems are only your own. So this is something that holds for individuals, but it also holds for groups and even organized groups. You feel as if these problems that you have are only your own, but as soon as you look over the fence, you realize they're not. So this sense of being able to overcome the segmentation of society is very important. And so the linkage that we are slowly, very slowly, building between academia, NGOs, and unions, of course, if things go well, and if you can imagine a more positive future, there's no reason not to expect, not to extend this triangle to four nodes, to five nodes, etc. To build this solidary network with overlapping, with an overlapping discourse and overlapping organizational structure, etc., etc. Well, I don't want to spend too much time talking, so I think I'll stop there and hand over the microphone to Katarin.
Okay, thank you very much. First, I want to say with what kind of glasses I will be discussing here. You said I am French, okay. I am involved, in fact, of course, for your discussion, I'm both an outsider and I would say insider too. Outsider, of course, obvious, and it's up to you to decide what to do at the level of the Balkan and to self-organize. And you don't need any kind of external, neither red teacher or any kind of person giving lessons. But on the other hand, I mean, I have always been a kind of insider. being, because we are in the same boat. I mean, as a political activist, internationalist, and fighting against both the capitalist system and with a critical approach of the experience, which we need all, we belong to, in a way, of course, the same boat. Resisting to a capitalist system which is globalized and in crisis, and second, because we need to share experience, and like you said, you have to build a Balkan international too. And I always have been here learning out of the Balkan experience, I would say, which is very rich. I hope that the Balkan will Balkanize Europe instead of the way it is often said in a quite racist and imperialist way, Europe has to Europeanize the Balkan. I would say the opposite, that you have to Balkanize Europe. The points I want to raise is linked three points to be short with the spirit of sharing the purpose of building something. You said that it is just the beginning and that it is a process. And so I want to raise some questions and make some comments in the spirit to help yourself also to precise your goals in a way. So the first point is the type of goal of group that you want to make related what you have called mapping workers' struggle. In each country and regions of the world where there are workers' struggles, of course, there is that organic need for the present struggle, like for the future, to establish organic alliance, I would say, between activists in trade union, in political association, in non-governmental association, and professionals. I would say perhaps it's not precise enough to formulate it as you say. Because trade union, NGO, and academics can be on both sides of the barricades. In practice, you have an integration of certain parts of trade union. It's not a specificity of the Balkan issue, even if you have specificity. NGO, I would criticize the NGOization of the civil society, which in Eastern Europe in particular, but not only, has been an instrument taken by Western powers to break, in fact, the former society, the role of social states, and also a real civil and democratic society. So NGO could be on both sides of the barricades. And even if they call themselves non-governmental, they could be very governmental and instruments of real existing governments in the way. And academics are also divided according class, I would say, issues and political engagement. That's why I would suggest that in the presentation of the project for the future publication, you are a bit more precise on the purpose around all those from trade union, political activity, or professional activity wants to support working class struggles, which is something which is a dividing line, of course, by different means, mutualizing, of course, knowledge, experience, but turning, and that is also perhaps something about the title of the group. Perhaps it's a question of English. I don't know. Mapping workers' struggles. perhaps it would could be clearer to reflect what you have introduced as the goal, to present it in the more dynamic way, in perspective, not a description, because you need and we all need more than a description and a photography. It has been said in the precedent debate also engagement on a collective struggle, activity, change very rapidly the state of. It's even more important than a program. It changed the behaviors, it changed the horizon of people. So it is very important to perhaps to precise, and that's the question for you, that the group is articulated towards a dynamic project of helping actions and helping solidarity, mutualizing. So that's the first point. I would say that in France, to give an example, we have built after big struggles which occurred at the end of the 90s in the public sectors, especially, different kind of institutions like a Copernic Association. Copernic meaning that we wanted to have a radical revolution in the way to articulate economy and social movements, to give the social movement the priority to change precisely economic relations. And the purpose of the foundations, of the institution, of the project in which trade unionists, sociologues, economists, activists were involved was to help social movement to have expertise on legal issues, counter expertise on all the lies which are put forward to legitimize around the debt issue, for instance, privatization against the pension issue, the transformation into a capitalist project, and so on. There are existing lies with official data which are to be opposed by counter expertise turned towards activity and action. And that could be, of course, the purpose of your group. Second point, briefly, the contextualization. It is a point which has been discussed in the other group before also, that is contextualization of the Balkan and the region transformation on the point of view of your topics, that is working class. That is what has been the transformation of the working class situation through the global process of capitalist privatization. When I'm speaking of contextualization as a purpose to be deepened in your further activity, I both mean first the question of which has been discussed and presented also in this very excellent, I read that yesterday, book. I suppose you integrate him in your, I think you have not quoted him, but he should, Goran Music, with all this excellent work, which should be put on the website of your research group, precisely as an asset on Serbia's working class in transition. And what I wanted to say, which is in that book and which is probably in your work to be done in the next future, and contextualization, meaning first you had 1989, then in the recent period in Eastern Europe and in the Balkans, a so-called catching up period with a certain euphoria of so-called success story around Slovenia and also the Baltic states, by the way, presenting the catching up in the years 2003 up 2007, let's say, with some euphoria and perhaps illusion, even of working people here and population, that a real good efficient capitalism was to be instituted here and which will bring a better life and so on. Perhaps those illusions existed. And then you have 2009. And since then, it has been said in the other discussion, we are entering a new period where we cannot foresee everything. It's not a clear-cut situation. For relationship of force is very difficult. It's open both to a very radical reactionary, like in Greece, by the way, but also in France and here and everywhere, nationalist xenophobia current, rightist current. But it is also a window of opportunity for working class activity, and that has been described here for Serbia in the last 3 years, but there is the example of Bulgaria, of Romania, of Kosovo now, and so on, and in Croatia and student movements, in all the regions, obviously there is a turning point, because when it was said that was the end of history in 1989, in fact, there is a real international systemic capitalist crisis occurring, and we are only at the beginning of it. It will last, and there will not be the disappearance of the capitalist system by itself if there is no alternative built at the level of decision making which existed for the bourgeoisie, which is precisely the problem of workers' resistance, social resistance globally. So in the task, this new period that is 2009 and now is of course to be analyzed with what you said about documentation. But then there is also an contextualization, the need to make the balance sheet of 1989. And here I want to make a bridge between the expectation of, in your group, perhaps of trade unionists and activists who want to have an answer now to what to do and how to organize the struggles better, and also those who want to come back on what you said about memory and understanding of history. I think, and I will brief on that, the issue for the Balkan and Eastern Europe of peripherization must be specified. I am a bit frustrated. I'm also using in my articles, of course, that fundamental truth that capitalist restoration meant a new peripherization of the whole Eastern Europe in the global capitalist system. And that is also, of course, true in particular for the Balkans, with very specific, even very military, direct intervention of foreign forces and so on. So you have also to make a concrete analysis on those so-called protectorates and their balance sheet in Bosnia, in Kosovo, and so on. That is also a task. So peripherization must be concretized. And here, I would say that there was a very specific issue, a specific goal for world capitalism, I would say. That is the suppression, the repression and the criminalization of all past anti-capitalist resistance. So, of course, the Yugoslav revolution was to be and is to be criminalized with a new official rehabilitation of so-called patriotic fascists and so on, and criminalization of the partisan war and so on. This is a key issue. But speaking of your topics, that is working class, it is an international issue, because the beginning of the, let's say, so-called neoliberal turn, which is a counter-revolutionary conservative turn in international capitalism, was a crisis of profit in the 70s and a crisis of the world capitalist order. And what was the issue which is to be implemented up to now, up to the end, is to destroy from memory, but also from relationship of force and from practical labor code, all attempt to give to working class a status precisely of human being owners and the possibility of an emancipatory project. And when I'm speaking of the working classes in the broad sense of it, men and women, qualified, non-qualified, rural and in agriculture, including peasants, by the way, not only industrial and rural working class. So all those, the labor force was to be reduced to a commodity. And this issue of the status of the working class and wage labor is the central issue for the world capitalist system to reintroduce through international competition precisely the status of workers as a simple commodity and to be hired off like that. And so this issue is combined with ideological fight, which is not only accumulation by depossession through privatization, but also depossession of your own history, depossession on the Yugoslav Revolution, depossession of the experience of anti-capitalist attempt, first attempt, historical attempt after the October Revolution to build socialism, of course, with contradiction, with failure, with a new problem which were not foreseen, like the bureaucratic issue you should integrate in the debate on democracy, which within the workers' movement and so on, but still an attempt to break with the capitalist domination. And this is to be suppressed by the real existing capitalism forces and through a criminalization of resistance and through the fact to present unemployed people as the one who are guilty of unemployment. Global ideology of too much protection bringing a non-efficient attitude and so on. This ideology of neoliberalism is to be defeated. And this is like when you speak, and it was spoken in the other debate of combination of a struggle for your group and the general need to win and build a new hegemony, it is including this attempt to delegitimate the past, to criminalize the past, and to reduce workers to not to human being but to commodities, to product that you use and then you push aside. And the third question, and I will finish on that, that is to be raised in your group, I suppose, I think, is the strategical issue. The strategical issue here, and it's also to be linked with two other debates, several debates that you had here in those days before, but especially the one on the commons and the last one on
towards capitalist Europe, and not because of the flag, for instance, flag tax, the taxes on that have been implemented in much more radical way, even introduced where it was nowhere in Eastern Europe. And the austerity discipline in budget policies have been much more radical in Eastern Europe than it has been in the south of the periphery. So that's because of a very specific and bad condition of relationship of force. Second point on feminist issues, the effect of the crisis on women in the world, I mean, there are texts I don't want to, but in particular points are known, I mean. First, of course, the destruction of public services are particularly affecting women, not only because often they are often much employed there, but also because of reproductive function and so on. They are on health issues and on education and childcare issues of course, affected by the privatization and the suppression of those rights. Secondly, there is a paradoxical, in a way, the transformation of the feminist workforce at the international level, that is the fact that in the 70s, 60s, 70s, there had been an increase in the participation of women in the workforce, but at the very same moment, because of the transformation, neo-capitalist, neoliberal transformation and attack, they have been at the forefront also on precarity, and the statistics, of course, of women in precarity and in employment is very high. And I want to stress one point here, which should be analyzed more precisely also. Besides the question which has been raised on unemployment, there is the question of what is the active population. And there has been a decrease of the active population itself. And among that is, what does it mean? It means people who stop
in front of the dominant transformation of the union. There is a strategical question for workers. And here, I have read and looked also on the website the information on the struggles here and so on. And there are two issues that I wanted to stress on politics for which are linked with your concrete situation, which have something to do with the situation elsewhere in Argentina, in France and elsewhere, but with specificity. The first one is when workers are taking back the factories, using the form, well, there is that Hugo Remedia, there was that beautiful video on Jedinstvo, which was presented also yesterday and so on. I do first remark, by the way, you say it briefly in your text also, it is very important. We have done it in France also for some struggles of the past of that kind, when workers are organized themselves, self-organizing themselves and taking back their factories and as a form of struggle. It is very important to build video and film it and organize solidarity and information through a video to give the possibility better than in meetings like that for workers to express themselves directly and including to express also. It is true for the young people, but it is also true for the oldest one, their experience and even the memory of the past. So video on those experiences are very important and to be translated in French, English, German and circulated to organize it. In France, we have invited a trade unionist coming from Argentina or from Thessalonica to organize solidarity around those kind of struggles. So this is one strategical possibility, but it is a very difficult issue in the capitalist environment. So that is, in the film yesterday, I saw that some workers said, well, we prefer to be exploited than be unemployed, and it's very difficult to take back the factory. We don't want to take the responsibility. And this is an important issue. Sometimes it's possible for workers to build cooperative. And in France also, in front of unemployment, it can be a solution of resistance. But in a capitalist environment, it's very difficult. In Argentina, the debate which existed for workers, for instance, in Zanon factories and so on, was an alternative choice between cooperative or asking for the state to nationalize the factories. But then we must organize a distrust towards the state. So I would formulate it in a nationalization under public control, under social control, in order not to leave any kind of responsibility to the state and organize the well. But this is an alternative strategic question, cooperative or state. And then I finish on that, the issue of common. I think it's there has been, and it has been described here by Goran Music, but I have studied that also in other East European countries. You have the key big factories of the past, which have been difficult to privatize, and which were places of socialization of the workers. which produce a certain kind of corporatist forms of resistance, which are a limitation for working class activity, but still forms of resistance. But now they are confronted to privatization or to suppression and so on, and to very bad situation. So the call for nationalization, socialization, but also what has been said in the debate, not only for those big factories which are in bad situation, but the issue of commons, that is the issue of education, the issue of health sector and so on, the issue of water, the issue of energy, and also the issue of car industry, which is to in overproduction and with, bon. What is the restructuring of all that? And through this, there is the strategical, political issue of democratic control and against both statism and against marketization and eventually possibility also of territorial sometimes articulation between rural and urban resistance, but giving and defending jobs to satisfy common needs. And this is a key issue for the discussion, I think, for everyone. So thank you very much. I think I would like it.
So thank you, Katrin. And I'm happy to say that we have at least 1 hour for discussion, maybe even those 15 minutes that we lost in the beginning, but 1 hour for sure. And just one technical remark. So if you want to address comment, some of the comments or questions maybe to some of the specific members of the group, which of course you do not have, but if you want to, then you can tell, I want, I don't know, Tibor or Heiko or anybody to answer. Just so if you do not do that, then all of us who think that cannot, that can respond are going to have a comment or answer or so on. So I open up the discussion. Okay, just one technical remark. Okay, sorry, just one more technical remark that I got just now. So at 2:30, the translator is going to, translators are going to leave. So after that, yeah, there is not going to be any translation. So, okay.
I have to respond to this last speech. I coming too late. I didn't get the whole, but it was long enough. And I think we should think about what we are doing here. We are trying to have a discussion to come different views in and different experiences to speech. And everyone which is speaking have to think about every word he says, another person cannot speak. And therefore you have to be in a very short way, if possible, as short as you can, and don't think we are silly. We know most of the things you said. We should try to concentrate on the problems which are in discussion with other, among us.
Thank you.
Yes, I think with the unions being under such public attack, we often, you know, find ourselves forced to defend them and say, well, they did some good and so on. But I think that at least here we should look at the hard truth. So at least in Slovenia, unions have become especially obvious now, but unions have been constantly trailing behind both the objective circumstances and their own rank and file. They have failed to react properly, or they were unable to react properly to austerity measures. Their members were self-organizing strikes when the union leaders did nothing, and even after, you know, self-organized strikes went place, started, they failed to go behind them. So I think there is a real problem here, and I don't think it's subjective, you know. Of course, there are corrupt and incompetent union leaders in Slovenia. There have also been cases of union leadership involved with the owners and so on. But I think the most important reasons are structures, and it has to do with what Silvia Federici stressed yesterday, that with social democracy, unions somehow became detached from the community and attached to the state. And this is, I think, especially visible in Slovenia, where unions play this intermediary all throughout the 90s, and even now play this intermediary role between the state and their rank and file. So on one side, okay, they did negotiate with the state, they negotiated many positive things for workers, they stopped many many bad reforms, but on the other hand, they were in a position when they also had to discipline the rank and file. So when they negotiated something with the state, it's a process of compromise, many, many different interests, a question of power, but when that was negotiated, they could not allow, you know, the rank and file to demand more than was already negotiated. And that caused a very strong alienation of the leadership from the base. And now that is a very important factor why the unions are so weak and why they are trailing behind what the government does. They're not even capable of stopping reforms. They're able to slow them down. That's the maximum they can achieve. And another consequence of this was, of their position, was intense competition between unions. So union leaders and negotiations behave, their goal is actually to maximize the difference between what their members get and what the other members get, not to maximize what their members get. There was an example only recently when, I won't name names, but one of the big union leaders, there was a legal dispute with the state regarding payments. Different units went through different channels, and one of these channels worked. And the union leader that went through that channel that worked wanted to achieve from the state that only his members get the money back and nobody else gets. So that there's a huge problem of this competition. So the fact that union membership has been declining is not so much, has not so much to do with bad communication or people not understanding what unions are doing, but that unions have a really deep structural problem that they have been unable to address. And so this connection, I think, is crucial. How to reconnect with the rank and file. Also, still now they're focusing very much on negotiating with the state and they're losing that battle, but they are focusing on that instead of, you know, working with the rank and file, organizing, reforming the organization, making it less hierarchical, and so on.
So just one more technical remark. If maybe you just could tell who you are when you speak. So thanks.
Thank you. I'm Maria Ivančeva from Bulgaria. I am a bit surprised no one reacted to the gentleman over there, because that's obnoxious. There is a lady that is the only one on a panel with a bunch of men who has been invited to comment on them. And she was scorned for taking the word for too long, given that, I mean, she has been invited here as a specialist and not only as, you know, yeah. But then the other thing, you know, like, and, you know, fact is, like, we're now speaking, I'm sorry, we're now speaking trade unions. There was not even one comment on female-male division of trade unions, maybe earlier than I came, because I didn't hear that. But I think, you know, like, this is perennial, and we're speaking about a very male-dominated young new left that is rising. And you know, seeing that no one reacts to this, I feel very personally offended. Secondly, I don't want to listen to you now. I'm sorry. You know, I wanted to ask you, why didn't you scorn Kostas Duzinas in the morning? Because you didn't do that. Second, you know, I like already, you know, on content. I wanted to hear more about, and maybe that's something that we can speak about here, or you know, find a forum for that. Successful attempts in the region in which the new left has been active in approaching trade unions and doing work with them. And what are the kind of, you know, limitations, constraints and so forth, because we know the failures, I think they're big, but I'm sure there has been, you know, instances that have been successful, but they're not very well known. So it would be interesting to kind of hear from people that are working on the topic what has been the case. Thank you.
Do we have anybody else with a common question? Yeah, okay, but now if nobody, then I will ask the members of the group maybe to, we have, okay. Okay, we have one more.
Anović Muhić iz, dolazim iz Srbije, dugo godina sam bila predsjednik sindikata, vodila sam najduže štrajk u Srbiji od 252 dana u izdavačkom preduzeću Prosveta koji je uspešno završen raskidom. Htela sam da kažem da uvek kao što u Beogradu govorim, niko nije protiv sindikata, nego sindikati i nevladine organizacije treba da se povezuju. U Srbiji je taj odnos nekako sindikati imaju veliko nepoverenje prema nevladinim organizacijama i plaše se povezivanja. Ja kad sam vodila štrajk, povezivala sam se sa drugim radničkim grupama preko Pokreta za slobodu i koordinacionog odbora. Znači, imate ko zna koliko štrajkova u jednoj zemlji, a mi ne znamo gde se ti štrajkovi vode. Zatim, kada govorimo o vođama na vrhu sindikata, pa normalno da su oni uz političku strukturu, polazeći od toga da su u kojekakvim upravnim odborima, gdje primaju ogromne pare, e sada je na nama koji u preduzeću vođama kažemo, kao što sam ja jasno rekla Orboviću, politika me ne interesuje, nego me samo interesuje preduzeće i radnici. Zašto je malo, sve manje članova, bar u Srbiji, sindikata? To su dva razloga. Prvo što Srbija je u velikom problemu zbog privatizacija, sve više preko 600.000 ljudi ostalo bez posla, što znači automatski toliko manje članova. A mladi kada se zapošljavaju u privatnim preduzećima plaše se da formiraju sindikat. Vlasnik koji kupio izdavačko preduzeće Prosveta imao je u svojoj matičnoj firmi 300 zaposlenih. Sve su to bili mladi ljudi, nije bilo sindikata. Koleginica iz drugog sindikata i ja ubeđivali smo ih da im pomognemo da osnuju sindikat, nisu smeli. Kada je otišlo preduzeće u stečaj, oni su svi ostali bez posla, nisu imali gde da zatraže svoja prava. Kada govorimo o reprezentativnosti, kao što je gospodin rekao da se često ne zna koliko ima članova sindikata, pa to bi moglo vrlo jasno da se zna kada bi postojala politička volja i sindikata i vlasti, jer oni zajedno pregovaraju preko listića za zaradu. Tačno može da se zna kome se odbija članarina, a kome ne. Nije dovoljno samo pristupnica, pa sindikati, pošto ih ima više i treba da ih ima više, manipulišu time. E, toliko. I za organizatora pitanje, žao mi je, nisam primetila da ima gostiju iz Bosne i Hrvatske, iz Bosne i Hercegovine i iz Crne Gore. Mi smo preko koordinacionog odbora i pokreta za slobodu imamo mnogo saznanja šta se događa u Hrvatskoj sa sindikatima, jer su nam bili gosti, kolege iz Varaždina. Toliko, hvala.
Ok, we have one more comment.
Pa evo, taman ću se nadovezati, ja sam Nedim iz Bosne i Hercegovine. Taman sam htio da malo komentaršem na temu stanje sindikata u BiH, sindikalnog organizovanja. U suštini situacija je sljedeća. Deindustrializacija, gubitak mnogih radnih mjesta, dolazi do smanjenja broja članova sindikata u proizvodnom sektoru. Trenutno najjači, najveći sindikat i onaj koji se najviše pojavljuje u medijima je Savez samostalnih sindikata Bosne i Hercegovine. U njemu vodeću ulogu vodi sindikat javne uprave i državne administracije, pošto najviše imaju jedini stalna, redovna primanja i najveća primanja prosječno u BiH, tako da najviše uplaćuju u sindikat i time upravljaju politikom sindikata. Sindikat taj sa svojim postupcima zadnjih godina radi je u suradnji sa vlasti, sa bilo kojim vlasti koja dođe u federaciji ili u BiH ili u kantonima, su sprezi, recimo nakon 2010. izbora u BiH, Savez samostalnih sindikata je potpisao takozvani platformu, zove se platforma, koju su činili Socijaldemokratska partija BiH, Hrvatska stranka prava BiH, Stranka demokratske akcije, znači govorimo o partijama koje su u svojim programima imali desne neoliberalne mjere, svi su se zalagali za privatizaciju. Savez samostalnih sindikata BiH se zalaže za liberalizaciju tržišta rada u BiH. Šta još tu spomenuti? Imamo par nezavisnih sindikata od toga, ali koji se većinom nalazi u Republici Srpskoj i sad zaboravio sam tačan naziv, ali okuplja u metalnoj industriji. Ja mislim da je 30.000 članova, međutim ne pojavljuju se medijima, ne pojavljuju se nikakve informacije o njihovom djelovanju, zaštiti svojih članova, zaštiti tih preduzeća. Zatim ima jedan pozitivan primjer koji moram spomenuti, a to je sindikat trgovine i uslužnih djelatnosti Bosne i Hercegovine, što je malo čudno jer govorimo o tercijarnom sektoru. Uključuje taj sindikat od 1996. godine, ima suradnju sa sindikatima iz Norveške i Švedske. Po svojom djelovanju, sve retorci su najprogresivniji sindikat trenutno u BiH. Žele, u saradnji su sa 11 granskih sindikata drugih koji, nažalost, zbog lošeg poslovanja tih preduzeća, većinom državnih, nemaju financija, nemaju načina da se suprotstave neoliberalnim reformama u BiH. Tako da zvaničnu progresivnu ulogu predvodi sindikat trgovine. Oni imaju trenutno 10.000 članova, imaju drugačiju organizacijalnu strukturu od ostalih sindikata, član su Saveza samostalnih sindikata, međutim u borbi su sa vrhom Saveza samostalnih sindikata, postoje čak prijetnje od vrha Saveza samostalnih sindikata u obliku, nedavno je održana peti kongres u Sarajevu i dobili su prijetnje, anonimne, međutim dobili su ranije od predsjednika da će biti nereda na njihovom kongresu, da neće organizati za 1. maj nikakve proteste, nego da će biti to 30. maja, to je Savez samostalnih sindikata, jer tad će radnici u BiH imati kao prvi slobodan dan. Ne razumijemo ni mi tu logiku, ali tako govori. Znači, ovaj sindikat je pozitivan primjer drugačijeg organizovanja, ali je primjer gdje sindikat ima financije uz pomoć svojih tih sindikata iz Norveške i može nešto organizati. Drugačije su organizovani na regionalnom principu, ima ih na teritoriji cijele BiH, imaju veću kontrolu od strane svoje baze i članova sindikata, radnika, tako da je to neko stanje sindikalnog organizanja u BiH. Hvala.
Gentlemen in the back one more time and then we go with the group members.
A short answer. Thank you. But I'm not a young man, I'm an old man. And I ask for your respect. I've been working as an activist 44 years in the radical left in Austria. I want you to respect this. And second, I want to say if there are experts which are invited, I'm an expert too. I am a worker for 30 years. I know what work is. And I'm not invited, I came on my own, I paid on my own, and this had to be respected.
Thank you. Okay, now I give word to Tibor because he was the first one, and then if anybody from the group has some kind of a comment or something, you just go ahead. And also for you, if something is raised in this that people from the group are going to tell you, just stop and give comments, questions, and so on. So thanks.
First of all, I want to thank our discussant for making this debate more live and putting in so many inputs into the delivery, so to say, this paper which we made. I want to say something more to add what Marco was saying about the dynamic of the group, and which is very elementary and basic. This is related to the language we speak. We figured out, I mean, already at the meeting, that we did not speak the same language. And also, Marco's interpretation of the document was a bit more formal than I would put it, as I would explain it. So we only had little time to interact on those issues. So I'm against more formal relations between NGOs, and we're actually discussing these things that we don't understand this interaction between NGO leaders or NGO or union leaders, because this is counterproductive. But my understanding of the main point was that we have to return to, and we actually started with the role of trade unions and understanding trade unions in being in a very contradictory situation given the conservative crisis or the very aggressive neoliberal crisis they face. And basically the document or the discussion had two levels. On the one level, we had the issue of, and we framed this as a trench warfare of the trade unions, or at least the trade unions which we understand as socially responsive trade unions. So they cope with significant resources. They still try to deal with, protect workers more and more according to the rules of the system. This was one point, and indeed we saw, and we had lots of voice from the unions too, who were saying that they lack capacities, they lack social support, and in that sense they are indeed in crisis, as Marco was saying. The other point was, and here for instance came up also an issue, the issue of corruption of unions, and this was one of the issues which was heatedly discussed. A very interesting discussion, but this is obviously not an issue which we can discuss at length. The other element, apart from the union part, and this goes back also, this crisis of unions in the society, is basically that unions have to rethink their strategies, their identities, and go back to their social roots. And going back by social roots also means, understanding, and again going back to the creation of new vocabulary, creating new ideologies, and creating more inclusive action. So we understood how important it is to create new collective identities, affirmative collective identities, emancipatory projects, among which. So we were also thinking, in this thing, we started thinking about whether unions have to reach out to non-members, to unemployed, etc. But for instance, I realized that this is only partial, and it's not a good expression. We have to, that a better expression would be to make unions more open, or to allow other voices to be heard. And then the issue of alternative agency can comes out as a spontaneous communities. For instance, what Catherine was also mentioning, and we were discussing this partly, the issue of films and film clubs to bring in various social actors, unions, and share experience, share forgotten histories, and cope with this general lack of collective memory. So approximately this is what I wanted to say.
I would like to add something. I was involved only in the work of the first day, so maybe I didn't have an opportunity to say this, but I think we don't need to narrow worker struggles only on the unions, because if we look at the structure of the societies we are now living, I think the unions, it's not the question of corruption of individuals in the union, I think it's the question if they are actually capable to do anything seriously, if they are actually capable in these kind of circumstances to create any important infrastructure that could really question some of the important issues in our societies. Unions are part of the factories, part of the capitalist society, but if you have destroyed factories and you, if you don't have many of the workers, then you can't have important unions. Unemployment rates are very huge. Unions are fragmenting workers because they are fighting amongst themselves in order to win new members. So there are, unions are mostly involved in internal conflicts amongst themselves. So I think that our society right now, and the living standard and everything, is much more fertile for the wildcat strikes. Strikes that were not authorized by the unions, but the strikes that were self-organized and that have some kind of self-organized direct actions. In my experience in Serbia, I think those kind of strikes were much more successful. Thank you.
Concerning Croatia, I would say there have been a few successes if the union supported those spontaneous strikes. Whenever unions organized struggles for companies in danger, Petrokemija Kutina or Jedinstvo showed that this can work. My impression is that in many other cases, you mentioned destroyed factories, and in many other cases, there was no support from the union's hierarchy, from the big confederations. There's a kind of alienation of the union hierarchy from the world those workers in the private sector are living in. Last year, workers on the island of Brač occupied Jadran Kamen, a company which stood before liquidation after a criminal kind of privatization. One example for this kind of privatization in Croatia. I, at the time, was in the country to interview a trade unionist, and I got answers about this case like, oh, we wish them to be successful, but violence is not allowed, I think. I think that the process of privatization in Croatia was violence, but the defense against it is non-legitimate violence, in the words of a trade unionist, or the textile factory at Kamensko in 2010 was closed, and I got the answer, oh, the workers should have accepted an earlier liquidation to find a new owner, but they didn't. In many cases, there's no perspective of struggle the unions have to offer to the workers. They don't really interfere in the wildcat strikes. That's the problem. They could. It's not impossible. They simply shouldn't be afraid to criticize private property as such in such cases, because other cases have shown that it can work.
We had here in the middle. Yes. Okay.
Yes. I have two small short questions for all speakers, but maybe especially Katrin Samari. As we probably all know, the gender wage gap is a fact. So I was thinking, what should be the part of a new strategy that emancipates working class, but that involves actually the feminist issues, the women's issues, the issues of women labor, especially in the context of the gender wage gap. And the second one is merely connected to the first one also, because we raised the question of importance of a strategy. How can we include in those strategies the problem of non-productive reproductive labor, unpaid labor, in those strategies which are dealing with the problems of current working class, the precarious flexi class, flexi working class, and so on. And just to remind us, there is actually a historical example of equal pay of men and women, and that was Yugoslav self-management.
We had two more here and there, and you also. So we have three more comments, and then afterwards I'll give the opportunity to Katrin Samari, Peter, and also Stipe and Marco if want to respond to anything. So thanks.
My name is Michael Graf from Austria, and this is actually just a short comment because, you know, these things are very context specific sometimes. But I was like 3 years ago, I was researching on Colombia and like trade unions and how they opened up towards social movements, which in literature they were talking about social movement unionism, which is an interesting example from Latin America. I know there are different circumstances, a different consciousness, but it's very interesting like how the trade union, within trade unions, they set up like an emancipatory education program, which they brought into the civil society, to social movements, and they had a big mobilization for the defense of the of Mcali, it was in Cali, for the company, and they were successful to defend the company, although this was constantly under stress. So it might be something interesting to look at, because this is also an interesting topic from the side of the trade union perspective. But at the same time, like from the Austrian experience in the alter globalization movement, where we also had trade unions coming towards civil society, towards social movement, I have to say this was rather a bad experience, because basically what happened is that the trade unions gave some money, like some summits were organized, but they didn't really integrate or open up organically to these demands. So just a comment, something to look into.
Hello again. I'm sorry, I didn't register last time that I was speaking Serb creation. I thought I was speaking in English, sorry. This time, I want to add something to the things I spoke last time, and to go with some proposals on what to do, what is to be done. With this trade union of the trade, there is another thing. They communicated with left organizations in Bosnia and Herzegovina and tried to do a cooperation with political left organizations, small organizations, young people, with the then existing Unified Organization for Socialism and Democracy, which is a point forward for any struggle in Bosnia and Herzegovina. Now, this organization disintegrated and integrated itself into another organization called the Left. This discussion will be picked up in the next time. There is another problem in the activities in Bosnia and Herzegovina. For example, in several state companies which have trade unions, there are several trade unions opposing each other. For example, the trade union in the public transport company in Sarajevo. We have a problem which they, for example, the drivers are opposed against all other workers in the company. We have a problem that the state companies are used for buying off the social peace by employing more people, and the side effects are that you are preparing the terrain of this state company to be privatized by making it not profitable in a capitalist system. The problem is the trade unions are not aware of it. The workers are not aware of it. The a recent strike in this company revealed that the workers are not sure what to do. They don't have any specific proposals. They are not searching for anything to do. They are, for example, they are not trying to ally themselves with people with anyone. There is no solidarity. The trade unions are atomized in terms. There is no at all connections between various trade unions. It could be a point to for any political left organ, left political organization or trade unions to map struggles, strikes in Bosnia-Herzegovina, to connect, to make a network, of, a new network beside the Savez Samostalni Sindikata Bosne-Herzegovine for solidarity between trade unions, between strikes. Then there is a problem of the strike law in Bosnia-Herzegovina, which diminishes any strike. There is no the only legal strike, which are the law, how they say, doesn't allow a real strike, anything to really put pressure to it. And a proposal would be for political left organizations, for trade unions, to change the law, because as it is now, it would allow intervention from the police, to it would allow to break the strike, to break any solidarity, any trade union move, workers' move. That's it. Thank you.
We have one here. Yeah, no, but here was first.
Thank you very much for presentations. I wondered if your working group addressed the issue that we tried to just touch also in the previous panel very briefly, namely the question of the unemployed. So like that was like one of the biggest, you know, blind spots of trade union organization, in a sense, what is, if there is like some kind of possibility nowadays, how to organize them. And then here you open up also the front towards the state, what Sasha was before talking about, because usually the unemployed are systematized, are kind of addressed only by the state agency of the employment. So here there could be this kind of interesting conflict developing around this issue. So a part of the precarious flexible workers, the unemployed, which is like kind of structurally 10 to 15%, and in the future it will only keep on rising, at least in the times of crisis. So this is the first kind of question to everyone. And then the secondly, even though I'm not representative of Slovenian trade unions or something, but just to try to answer, I agree with most of the criticism, and it has to be harsh. But at the same time, I would also like to say, at least in Slovenia, the trade unions succeeded a few times to stop neoliberal reforms. They slowed them down, true. But at the same time, they used the instrument of referendum, which is at this time in Slovenia being under attack. And it's been a few weeks ago that the first popular assembly kind of was not initiated by trade unions, but at the first time that they came to the uprising or to the social movement sphere. So the trade unions, even though from what you could say very selfish reason for referendum as instrument, stepped into the realm of the popular struggle. So in this sense, of course, they come always with the delay or problematically and so on, but I think that in the future they might be a very important link to the building of the social movement in Slovenia.
Thanks. Gentlemen in the back, and please, since it's your third time, just to be brief. Just to be brief, if possible, because, you know, it would be good to hear.
I want to make the position that trade unions, as trade unions, are a organization of class cooperation. Why? Because they have to accept capitalism, they have to accept slavery in the fabrics, the boss is the one who has to say, and the workers are the one which have not to say. They are some sort, in schools we elect speakers of the pupils, and they are making deals with the teachers too, but that doesn't mean that the position of the pupils are in the same level. And therefore, I think trade unions are organizations of class cooperation by the reason of entrance of this organization. You have to accept capitalism. You are only allowed to talk about the higher of wages, which how much money you can get to be a slave, and of the working conditions. And you are not allowed to speak what's going on in the whole of the society, and that you don't accept that you are worked the whole time. You have to accept that your boss make profits. And if he said we cannot make profits, you have to accept it, because you accept these circumstances.
Thanks. Maybe some more comments? This, okay, one more.
Just to clarify, perhaps I wasn't perfectly clear before. Of course, Gal, I agree completely with you, and that's what I put forward, that those criticisms. Unions will be extremely important. It's important to do these things, to politicize and to engage them in political struggle, establish connections between them. Now different unions talk with each other only at negotiations with the government. They don't talk outside of that. So these things, establishing a link to the rank and file, connections with the unions, and politicizing the unions.
Okay, thanks. I don't see any arms in the air. So first I would give word to Peter and then to Katrin to answer, and maybe Stipe or Marco, you haven't said anything so far, so afterwards, yeah. So Peter.
Hello, everybody. My name is Petre Damo. I'm coming from Teachers Union in Romania. I'm a regional leader of a teacher union, and at the same time, I'm an activist in the Romanian Social Forum. I would like to make a few comments or remarks on what has been said so far, as well as on the draft we ourselves tried to put up. First of all, I think it would be useful to enlarge upon the issue of austerity. First of all, I think there is a specificity of austerity in the region, in Central Eastern Europe and in the Balkans. Namely, I think that austerity and austerity measures have been used as a pretext to the enlargement and implementation of the neoliberal paradigm in the area. Secondly, I think that the effects of austerity taken in Central Eastern Europe, including the Balkans, have been much worse than, in terms of effects, have been much worse than those felt in other countries in Europe. Next, at least as the case of Romania has been, I would say that this region or countries in this region have been used as a laboratory experiments to test the neoliberal paradigms and the austerity measures implemented by the Troika that would be next enforced and exported throughout Europe. I can argument by a simple example. Austerity measures have been implemented in Romania beginning with 2010. We had cuts in the public sector by 25%. We had cuts in pensions and children's allocation by 15%. We had raised the VAT from 19% to 24%. This was done even before the Troika officially put forth the six-pack and the rest of austerity measures. So it was an experiment. And only after that you had the cuts in Portugal, in Spain, and in Greece. We had the cuts 2 years or 3 years before that. It was an experiment conducted by the Troika in Central Eastern Europe, and probably in other countries as well. This would lead me to the last issue related to austerity, which was mentioned by Catherine, and that is peripherization of the region. And it all falls together under this pretext as austerity measures. Then I would go to another issue which was pointed out by some of the speakers today, as well as in the document, the issue of corruption. I think it would be, even if it's a disturbing issue, especially for trade unions, trade unionists, I think it should be much more well defined in terms of concepts. So what do we mean when we talk about corruption in trade unions? Is it the fact that these are just questions? Is it the fact that some national trade union leaders, now this is the case of Romania, are cooperating with the neoliberal government? Is it the case that some trade union confederations and federations are working like an NGO in the sense of promoting European structural programs involving zillions of euro, which are taken through government, through their governments, or what is it? So we should be more specific about this. Then there is the issue of education. This was raised in the final part of the draft, and I think many of the speakers touched it. I think education should involve developing political culture and the culture of protest, the culture of class struggle, as opposed or as in some cases opposed and in other cases in concordance with the social dialogue. I don't want to criticize social dialogue, but we have to be careful how this is used by the neoliberal political class. I would give another example from Romania. In 2011, they made up a new law, which is called the Code of Social Dialogue. It is nothing but a code of social dialogue. It is a law that restricts very much the rights of trade unions, the right of members of trade unions, and generally social and legal rights. And it's put under the name of social dialogue. So this is why we should be careful about what we mean when we talk about social dialogue. Then I would like to say a few words about the strategic objective of this seminar, which was again raised by some of the speakers. So obviously we want to move on with this building up of a network between trade unions, NGO activists and social movements as well as academics. And I think it would be good to consider the existing processes throughout Europe. One has to take into account that such a process exists in the Joint Social Conference process launched in Brussels, where you have big trade unions from Europe, you have social networks and NGOs involved, and they are all pushing against the austerity measures. Deriving from the Joint Social Conference, you have the Alter Summit process, which had a 2 days meeting here in Zagreb, and it is quite successful. They are going to organize the Athens Alter Summit and protest with the demonstration in June. I think it's exactly that we shouldn't just singularize or isolate ourselves, but just take a look upon what is going on around and maybe see ways of connecting with the processes going on. That would be all so far.
Is it my turn now? Or Catherine first? Yeah.
Yes, thank you. So three points. First, to support what Peter just said about Eastern Europe as being a first laboratory, even before the southern periphery, I use the formula that is the idea that on many respects, the core countries
are going towards the Eastern Europe and not because of the flat, for instance, flat tax, the taxes on capital has been implemented in much more radical way, even introduced where it was nowhere introduced in Eastern Europe. And the austerity discipline in budget policies has been much more radical in Eastern Europe than it has been in the southern periphery. So that because of a very specific and bad condition of relationship of force. Second point on feminist issues, I mean, the effect of the crisis on women in the world. I mean, there are texts, I don't want to, but in particular points are known. I mean, first, of course, the destruction of public services are particularly affecting women, not only because often they are often much employed there, but also because of reproductive function and so on. They are on health issues and on education and childcare issues, of course, affected by the privatization and the suppression of those rights. Secondly, based on unemployment, there is the question of what is the active population. And there has been a decrease of the active population itself. And among that is, what does it mean? It means people who stop declare as looking for jobs, and even are not officially unemployed. They are simply out of the active population. And the share of the inactive population is particularly high here. And behind that, there is a specific something to be studied about the articulation between rural and the working class. There was a tradition, there was a specificity of the Yugoslav, especially working class, that is to keep links with the countryside and going back to the countryside is a way, but for self-fooding and not for market, is a form of going out of the active population in certain cases, and women can be a big part of that. On the strategic, then the last point with poverty, the international involvement of trafficked of women in trafficked for prostitution is something which is particularly heavy in Eastern Europe, and it must be analyzed also concretely as an effect of the working poor and the transformation of the society. Then the key issue for women activity is linked with the debate which occurred before also, is within the workers' movement, within the association, within the trade union, within direct democracy, the role of women and the fight against the reproduction of male domination spontaneous. And the last point on trade union is to say that I certainly agree with the gentleman behind that some trade union are a real instrument of class cooperation. And unfortunately, it's true for many of them, but it is not, I would, if we say that it is a general feature, then we live, I think it's very pessimistic. I hope you are not right, and I think you are not right. I mean, there are, and it is an issue in all countries to fight for radical trade union, to resist integration. And one of the points of the ALTER summit that you were quoting, and I'll finish on that, is precisely to try to involve radical part of trade union, and especially there have been a very recent a recent turn, which is not enough, among even the dominant trade union, to criticize for the first time the austerity pact at the European level. But the issue, which is not clear, is to either transform from within the trade union to build radical wings and branches and so on, or to build new trade unions and involve them in the class struggle. And that is an issue for the ALTA summit, which is very important. Thank you.
Okay, Stipe.
I would like to pick up where Katrin just stopped with the question of the function of trade unions. Well, if you look, one must never forget historically the fact that trade unions exist is the consequence of struggles. It was an institutional right for the working class to organize. This has not always been the case, and we see today again that unionization is systematically attacked. So obviously there is a limit to the functionality of trade unions as an institution for capital. Otherwise, we wouldn't see these anti-union laws and so on and so on. So, but one fact, and there is an, I would argue there is another structural limit to the functionality of unions of or to this entire social dialogue ideology. And Catherine has already pointed it out. It is the question of limits of profitability. Because if we were discussing which entry point should there be for the search for strategic alliances, for creating a new hegemony, and Catherine has said it has to be class, and this is precisely the case, because we have to ask ourselves, and also unionists and the rest of us, what does it mean that capitalism is a class society? It does not just mean that there are differences in lifestyles and consumption standards. It means that fundamentally that you have a form of organization of production and reproduction of a society where the dominant rationality is class is the profit motive. So we so structurally this is a class society in the sense that that it is biased towards profitability, and if you have that as the central logic and the central rationality organizing a reproduction, that is fundamentally at an antagonistic relation to the interests of the broader working population. So in this sense, there is historically neoliberalism is precisely the proof of that. That there was a limit to the possibilities of class compromise and of integration. That there is, we are now living in a historical period where this antagonistic character between the interest, between the centrality of the profit motive, and the advocation of the interests of the majority, is obviously antagonistic. And the question is now only how to move from that as a general diagnosis of the historical period we are living in to integrate this and make this a central point in all attempts to organize and link up with between different sectors and so on. So
I will just shortly react what you said that interest, I was reminded yesterday in a communication that we have to think about interest, but often the identity is more important than interest. But this is a one issue, but what I want to address especially here is what Katrin asked about the strategic issues for workers and unions, especially for unions. At the working meeting there was a very nice example. We were reminded of how important education and learning is. And there was one unionist who was saying that, and Marco was mentioning this, that he understood the union as a living organism, which always have to communicate with rank and file, with various levels, with various unions of the hierarchy, both vertically and horizontally. And he was explaining that what they do is that they go down, they talk to people, they say something, and then they come back and they discuss what they learned and what they said, and they rethink. And this is a kind of dialectical learning, which is in a way exemplary how an inclusive organization should work. Constant dialectical learning. One more note on the wage equality. So it might be the case that under self-management in Yugoslavia, it was an exception, but if you read, for instance, Susan Woodward's book, it also explains, you know, like some of the problems of the system. And one of the conclusions, it's not the main conclusion, but related to female workers, it was only Slovenia which did not have unemployment. All the other republics have much higher levels of unemployment, and especially among women. So female unemployment, and in that sense, Yugoslavia was more in line with the southern patriarchal states, So this was basically in some regions, some republics, basically a very conservative state.
Okay, so now it's 2:30, but we still have 15 minutes. So I'm glad to see that you do not want to stay anymore, but since we have 15 minutes and this is important topic, now I'm going to be in a position where I'm going to hold you some more. So I expect some more comments, some more questions, because I mean, it would be really a waste of time to waste 15 minutes. So please, we still have time. There is a, yes. Arm raised there.
Hi, my name is Chiara. I have a question about the legacy of socialism, especially for former Yugoslavia, especially when it comes to trade unions. So I haven't studied this, or it's just a curiosity out of doing some research into textile workers in the region. And I could see that there was this idea of the trade union as something that would be, on the one hand, some sort of instrument of organization of labor and organization of the productivity of labor, and also some sort of organism that was, you know, dealing with, for instance, workers' holidays, or more generally some welfare services. So my curiosity is about to what extent this legacy of the trade union as something that is related or connected to the state somehow is still present now. Is that the fact of that the trade union is not so conflictual, so to say? Am I reading too much into this, or can you comment upon this issue, please? Thanks.
Okay, thanks. From the back.
I told yesterday in another panel that we worked with Territorio Domestico, which are organizing houseworking people in Madrid. And they told us, of course, the houseworking women are coming from other countries, also Ecuador, Argentina, and they started to make a collective action. Okay, and they have no choice to make it in a trade unionist way, because they have to deal with racism, they have to deal with immigration laws in the core of her work, and they cannot organize as. And a little story, it was very funny. They are not ideologically against trade unions, but they try to make contact to the trade unions, and the trade unions say, yes, come to our office times, we are opened from 9 to 4. And they cannot get this time out of the work in the house. They meet on the Sunday in 17 o'clock in the evening each week, and then they have the free time. But no trade union works on Sunday 17 p.m. Yeah?
Okay, thanks. Now we still have Marco to answer this last question, and maybe something more, since you're the only one that hasn't said anything, and then I suppose there are going to be some comments.
Well, just briefly regarding the self-management issue, this may be a bit too technical, but on the whole, yes, you're right. Unions were part of the political establishment. In that sense, they were really closely connected to the party. But it's difficult to generalize this because of the whole decentralized nature of Yugoslavia. So locally, this may look a bit different. I don't see it as problematic that unions organized vacations, etc. Yeah. It's problematic if this is the only thing they did. At the same time, you had workers' councils in each company. So what the workers' council did could be something opposed to the union. Sometimes this did take place. But as I said, this depended from, it was different according to republic, according to industrial sector, etc. So regarding the gender issue, I'm not sure if the colleague from Bulgaria is here, but just to defend the group a little, we had a good mix of men and women in the group, and we especially had the good fortune of having Asna Petrovic there, and she's done a lot of work that is feminist in nature. So I think, and on the whole, I don't think we neglected the male-female problematic in our discussions. Maybe it didn't come through today, but I think we're all well aware, and even the unionists. I mean, there's no need to idealize the blue-collar worker in the former Yugoslavia. There's plenty of chauvinism there, but even the unionists who were men were pretty, feminist, if I could say so.
Okay, one last chance. If not, then I would like to thank everybody. And please do send us your maybe comments. I mean, we are all available through email. We are going to work on this paper for the next month. So, oh yes, Peter says that we should thank translators, but they are not anymore here, but we can thank them, of course, yes. So for the translator. So, thanks everybody, see you next time.